Good morning, everyone. My name is Werner.
And I'm Lisa.
And we just want to bid you a warm welcome. But before we start, we want you just to turn to someone sitting next to you and just share with them the highlight of your weekend so far. We're giving you 1 minute. Let's do it. Wonderful. Thank you. I trust that everyone has a seat. So awesome to see you here this morning.
Yeah, it's so great to have so many visitors here this morning and a lot of people from other Shofar churches. Always lovely to see you here. And we are really excited to spend this morning with you. If you may be here for the first time or you're new to church, not a visitor, but you're kind of in Hermanus and you're new, we'd love you to just, if you just could just raise your hand. We've got a little box for you with the chockey inside and a card. Just raise it up. The chocolate
yes,
is good.
Yes, there's a hand. Let's give that lady a clap. Thank you.
Just keep it raised until you receive the welcome pack. On there's a little card. We'd love for you to just fill that in for us so that we can contact you in the week and get you connected. And then there's an offering basket outside or just at the door where you can just throw your card in.
Awesome. If you are here from a different Shofar congregation, won't you just put up your hand and just wave to us? Wow. Let's just give them a warm welcome, a clap. Welcome, guys. Awesome to have you here. Just back to those in Hermanus, if you are here and you're new in town or you are new in church, we would love you to join a small group. But that is your next step if you've made it to the Sunday service. And so we've got a one-stop table. If you go out that door and into that little building there, there is an info desk. And there, if you put up your name, basically you can ask any question. Just put your name and number down, and we'll get back to you. So if you want to join a small group, just say, small group, Peter is my name, and here's my number, and we will connect you.
Great. And your next step in church, if you're new or if you haven't done the Encounter series before, we'd love for you to come to Encounter 1. It will be up there soon. There we go, special date. Encounter 1, 14th of April at 6:30. And that's your place to start. And it's an amazing place to just get to know what the church is about and to actually have a real encounter with God on that day. So we'd love for you to join us. And then also at Children's Church, at the moment we are focusing on Jesus the Messiah made a way for salvation. So yeah, we're excited God is doing incredible things at Children's Church. And we have to expand because we can't fit in all the kids. So we're excited about that. God is doing amazing things.
Yeah, and we just want to thank you for your generous giving over this time. We don't send around the offering basket just to in line with COVID protocol. So we've got a little box there by the door. You are welcome to contribute into that box if you want to. So I'm going to pray for the offering, and then we're going to spend some time in worship with a band. Lord, I want to thank you for this incredible morning, and thank you for the ability to give you our hearts and also our financial means as you lead, Lord. And thank you that you've been so good to this church. We've never lacked. We've been able to reach people and take the kingdom forward because you have always provided. And we just honor you for that, Lord. Amen. Hendrik, I give over to you.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Let's stand as we just start this day off right. Yeah, Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we can be in your house this morning. Such a glorious day of celebration. Lord, we bring our hearts before you. We pray that, Father, we will just enter into your presence now in this time, a special time that we put aside just to worship your name, to glorify the name of Jesus Christ. But Lord, today is just so special. Father, today is such a big celebration. You have overcome. You have overcome death. So Father, we will sing. We will glorify your name like never before. Let's just use a few moments. Let's just enter in his presence. Prepare our hearts as we worship him, as we glorify the name above all names. Worship today, the Lord just wants to come do something in your life. He wants to come and just turn our focus back to what he has done and just how big that really is. And no matter what we face now currently in the world, in our lives, in our own little bubbles, we can always look to what Jesus has done for us, and nothing is too big for him. Amen. Amen. Let's sing out of a place of hope today. We have hope in the Father.
We sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty.
Hallelujah.
You are holy. Stars they were, the morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world has fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon. Death, where is your
on, church. We sing. We sing. Hallelujah. Stirring in our hearts, let's sing. Your sting. Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. We just glorify you today because of that. Amen. Come on, church, let's sing.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. And Christ is risen from the grave. And all throughout eternity, our song will be the same. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Come on, church. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. And Christ is risen from the grave. Yes, he has. And all throughout eternity, our song will be the same. Hallelujah.
Share a scripture, or you have an image that you want to share with the church, we'll have the microphone here in front with Werner. Feel free to come and share that. Let's just remain a few moments more into this, in this precious time, just worshiping the King.
Yeah, let's do business with the risen one this morning, amen. Let's just close our eyes and just remember. Let's just remember this day. You know, in this world, you have to hide your sin, you have to hide your weakness, or you get judged, or you get fired, or shown away. But with Christ, there's the forgiveness of sins, amen. So it's the opposite in the world. We can bring our sins. Ephesians 1 verse 7 says, because of him, there is the forgiveness of our sins. And so what I want us to do is let's press into him and let's repent of our sins this morning. It is not a foreign thing for a believer to do. Amen. Let's close our eyes. Let's say, Lord, let me just clean my heart here, because I may come. I may come. I can bring my weakness before you. In front of the world, it's sometimes dangerous and I feel I have to hide, but before you, I can bring and say, Lord, forgive me my stubborn heart. Forgive me my pride. Forgive me what I said. So right where you are, let's do business with God. Let's pray in this place. Let's go to the Savior. That's why he died. Amen. That's why he died, so that we can come with our sins and our weaknesses. We do not have to hide it. We just lift up our hearts this morning, Lord. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins, Lord. If there's something heavy on your heart this morning, take it to the cross. So, Lord, this is heavy for me. I bring this situation to you. I bring my heart to you. Where else will we go? thank you, Jesus, that because of Easter, because of your death and your resurrection, those who know they are weak and come to you will never be shown away. They will always be welcomed as they come with humble hearts, repenting of their sins and clinging on to the Savior. It is that which we celebrate this weekend, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you came for the whole of Hermanus and the whole of the Western Cape and the whole of South Africa and the world, and we are not afraid to say it, Lord. That is why we sing, the Savior of the world is in our midst. We worship you, Lord.
Yes, Father, we thank you also. In the midst of your sacrifice for our sins, we have confidence to come to you. Because we are not just forgiven, we are accepted. And so, Lord, we come to you this morning, and we ask that you will speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning, everybody. It is the greatest day in history. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. He is alive. And so we celebrate this day with all Christians all over the world. Jesus is alive. And that is not just great news. It has huge implications for us as believers. He is indeed who he said he was. The resurrection proves that he is indeed who he said he was, the Savior, the Son of God. And with that, all things that he promised is true. It's amazing to know that through the resurrection, we can know for sure that Jesus is who he said he was. And Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And so that what we know and have seen and heard of him in Scripture is also true today and will be true tomorrow. You know, John 11 verse 25, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never lie. I shall never die. Lie also, but Jesus was saying, yeah, shall never die. And then this question, do you believe this? Do you believe this? That I am the resurrection and the life. And if you believe in me, you will never die. You will live for eternity. Question this morning is, do you believe this? 2 weeks ago, I was at Kids Church and we were doing the account of Lazarus and his death and resurrection. You must really go there. There's more angels there than here. And as I was fulfilling the role, I was playing the role of Jesus. And as I was preparing and just reading this account again, I was just struck again by what God is saying. I am the resurrection and the life. And the context in which he said it so powerfully. We know the account so well. When Jesus finally got to the family, Lazarus was already dead for 4 days. And so Martha was the first one that ran to Jesus and fell at his feet and said, Lord, if only you were here, my brother would still be alive. And then Jesus said, and we read here from verse 23, and Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Your brother will rise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. I know he's going to rise in the future. And then Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he dies, will live. Do you believe this? And then later on, as Jesus got to the grave and he said to them, they must remove the stone, Martha again said in verse 39, Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there is a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days. And then Jesus said to her, did I not say to you, if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? When he said, I am the resurrection and the life, he did not mean only for one day. He meant for now, here, today. I am the resurrection and the life. And so powerfully, Jesus still asks us today, do you believe this? Do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life, not just for one day, but for today? Christ's resurrection was not just for one day, it was for today, here and now. I am the resurrection and the life. Martha, do you believe this? And then Jesus said, Lazarus, come out. And he did. Because Jesus is not just the resurrection and the life for one day when he returns at the last day. He is for here and now today. The question is, do we believe this? And what does his resurrection mean to us? What does it mean to us here and now today in this life at this time? Now, first of all, we mentioned that the resurrection proves that he is indeed the Son of God. I mean, Jesus appeared to more than 500 witnesses. It is proof that he's not just alive, but that everything that he said is true. And the second thing that the resurrection so powerfully proves that is applicable to us here and now is the fact that he overcame sin and death so powerfully. Death, where is your sting? Where is your power? It's been destroyed. I have overcome it for you. He did it for us. Jesus didn't die. He didn't sacrifice himself for himself. He did it for us. He wasn't raised for himself. He was raised for us. He was the last Adam that paved the way for all of us to follow. That in him we may too have life. He died as a sacrifice for our sins so that we don't have to face the wrath of God for our iniquity. We were justified through him. That's Romans 4, verse 25. For he was delivered over to death for our sins. And he was raised to life for our justification. He did it for us. Something that we could not do for ourselves. The law was given only to show us what sin is and that we cannot even, as much as we try, be perfect in God's sight. So the law was there to prove to us not just what sin is, but that we cannot in ourselves be justified. We need a Savior. And so God sent His Son to be the Savior, to be the righteous one, to be the perfect one that will be sacrificed on our behalf so that through faith in His sacrifice, just like the Israelites had to believe in the blood of the Lamb to smear it on their doorposts, so those who believe in Christ's sacrifice will be passed over. Judgment will pass you over because you will be declared justified, righteous, redeemed, blameless before God. Not because of who you are, but because of who He is. Not because of what you have done, because what He has done. That's the good news of the gospel. The resurrection proved all that. You see, we need a Savior. Romans 5 continues from verse 6. You see that just at the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. For very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrated his love towards us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? And not only this, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now receive reconciliation. How powerful. Romans 6 speaks of what Christ did for us and how it is relevant to us here, now, today. It speaks of an aspect, not everything, but there's another reality of what Christ came to do for us in the context of our sin and our sinful nature that causes us to sin, and why he had to come and what he established through his death and resurrection. Christ's death was for us. His resurrection was for us. His death was to deal with our sin, and his resurrection was to empower us to live for God. Very powerfully. His death was to deal with this, with our sin, but his life, his resurrection, was to empower us to live for God. And so we read in Romans 6 from verse 3, "Or do you not know that as many of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus was baptized into his death? Therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we should also walk in newness of life." Just like Christ was raised from the dead, so we too should walk in newness of life. His death was to deal with our sin. His resurrection was to empower us to live for God. So we were placed in Christ on the cross. Our sinful man died with him. Romans 6 verse 6, "Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. But if we were also raised with him," this is profound, "we did not just die with him, we were also raised with him, that we should be free from the power of sin." His death dealt with sin and the power of sin so that we can be free to live for God. Romans 6 from verse 5 continues. It says, "For if we've been united in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. For he who died has been freed from sin." I believe if Jesus was here today, he would be asking us this simple question: do you believe this? Do you believe this? You know, there's so many Christians that believe in the forgiveness of Christ, but they still live as if the freedom from sin is still going to be one day when he returns. One day. On the last day, when Jesus returned, then finally, we will be free from sin. Many of us respond like Martha. "Yes, Lord, I believe when you return, at the last day, when I am resurrection, then I will be free from the power of sin." You know, God says you're already free. "I have overcome death and sin. And you were crucified with me, but you were also raised with me so that you too can be free. Do you believe this?" Martha, do you believe? And And many of us are still struggling with sin. And I'm not talking about the occasional sin, but a pattern, a habit, something you just can't break free from. And you believe you cannot be free in this life, here and now. I believe Jesus is saying to you today, did I not say to you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? I am the resurrection and the life, not just for the last day, but for today. Do you believe this? I did not just die for your sin. I was resurrected for your freedom, so that you can live for me. But first, you need to believe. You see, it is not you that overcomes sin. It is His Holy Spirit in you. But you must believe. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead now lives in you. Do you believe this? Romans 8 verse 11 says, But if the Spirit who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. Do you believe this? Romans 6 continues from verse 10. It says, for the death that He died to sin once and for all, but the life that He lives, He lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. You see, the death that He died to sin once and for all, but the life that He lives after the resurrection, He lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. But you know what? First, you need to believe it so that you can reckon yourself to be dead indeed. You must first believe. And then you will see the glory of God. But there's something even more powerful what Christ's resurrection meant for us. What His resurrection enabled us. Far more than sin and its consequences. It was something far greater. Sin was simply what prevented us from something more amazing, more powerful, and more wonderful. It was so powerfully portrayed when at the point of Jesus' death, the veil in the temple that separated us from God, the veil that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies, that no man could enter because of our sinfulness, because of our iniquity. Only one man once a year, after he'd made a sacrifice for himself and the whole nation, could dare to enter into it. That what separated us from God was torn in half. We now have access to God. The most powerful thing of the resurrection is that we have been redeemed, forgiven, declared holy so that we can come back to God. We have been reconciled with God so that we can have fellowship with Him. So that we can come into His presence. We no longer need a priest to go on our behalf. Christ did it for us so that we now can come into God's presence. The most powerful thing the resurrection did. That what prevented man from entering the Holy of Holies, our sin, was dealt with once and for all. So that we can have fellowship with God. We have been reconciled with God. Reconciled to a relationship. Many Christians live in the reality of God's forgiveness, but not in the reality of the purpose of that sacrifice. We understand that we've been forgiven. We believe that we've been forgiven. But we don't fully live in the reality of what it means to be forgiven. It means you can come to me now. You can have a relationship with me. Reconciliation to a relationship as in the beginning. The Word of God calls it fellowship. Fellowship. What a powerful word in Greek. We can have fellowship with God. We can have fellowship with God who is the source of life, who is life. And therefore, we can have eternal life because of a relationship with Him. The definition of fellowship in Greek, koinonia, is a powerful word. It means partnership, participation, and intimacy. We can have fellowship with God, a partnership, a participation, an intimacy with God. It speaks of a fellowship with God that leads to an intimate relationship. And this is what the resurrection established for us. That through Christ, we have been reconciled to God and we can have fellowship with Him. We can have partnership, participation, and intimacy with Him. John 17 says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you." That they may know you. That they may have an intimate relationship with you. The only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Fellowship with God, to know Him intimately. To know the source of life, the giver of life, the sustainer of life personally. And this relationship, this intimacy with Him lead us to eternal life. Because we are in fellowship, because we are abiding in the source of life, we have eternal life. In 1 John 5, we read of this. It says, "And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life." Because it's in this intimate fellowship, relationship with Him that we have eternal life. And so we know John 3:16, that is why He came. He loved us, so He gave His Son, that so whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Where is this life? In His Son. And in a relationship with His Son, we have this, that we know Him. We have fellowship with Him. If we have fellowship with Christ, fellowship with God, we have eternal life because He is life. If you have partnership, participation, intimacy with God, you have who He is. It's life. And the Apostle John describes Jesus to young believers that have never met Him. They've never seen the incarnation. They've never seen Jesus on earth. They've never met Him in the flesh. And so John writes to new believers, and listen how he describes Jesus. In 1 John 1 from verse 1, that what was from the beginning. Genesis 1, John chapter 1. Which we have heard, which we have seen with the eyes, which we have looked upon, which our hands have handled concerning the word of life. I am an eyewitness. I have touched, I have seen, I have handled the word of life. Life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life that was with the Father was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you that your joy may be full. What a powerful statement the Apostle John makes. John, that saw, that touched, that handled, that lived with Christ for 3 years. I mean, how many times have I longed? Maybe you've been like this. How amazing it would have been to be one of those disciples, just to live in the time of Jesus, to see him minister, to hear him preach. How about being one of the 12 that was there when that followed Jesus? How amazing it would have been, that relationship, that fellowship, that intimacy, that partnership. How amazing it would have been here, the Apostle John writes that we too can have the same fellowship. I mean, John, when he was writing, Jesus already ascended to heaven. He was no longer on the earth. But John still had a relationship. He still had fellowship with God. He still had a participation, a partnership, and an intimacy with God. And he said, I'm writing these things to you so that you can know you can have the same as I have. You can have the same fellowship. John describes Jesus as the word of life, the life and eternal life. What was most profound is that he says that you can have the same relationship as I have with him. That's why I'm writing these things to you. Do you believe this? I guess the best example would be the Apostle Paul, who never knew Jesus in the flesh. He never saw him in the flesh while he was here. He had an encounter with Jesus after the ascension. And his life changed. And he had a relationship, a fellowship, a participation, a partnership, an intimacy with Christ. You know what? John writes, Paul writes these things to us to tell us the good news. That because of Christ, we too can have a relationship with God the way they have. We can be as close to God as anyone in the Bible. You can be as close to God as anybody in the Bible. Because Christ came to die for all of us. The veil was torn for all of us. Not just for the high priests. Not just for the pastors. But for all of us. We have all been adopted into the family of God. We've all received the Spirit of God by which He cries out, testifies with our spirit that we are all together children of God. And if children, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, we have all received the same Spirit that is the seal, the proof that we indeed belong to God, accepted by God, received to Him, and we are all His children. We have all have the same access to the same Spirit. We all have the same access to the same throne room of God. We all have the assurance that when we call out on His name, He hears us. We're all the same. We can have the same relationship as John. That's why he writes. This is good news. But most importantly, the veil has been torn. Yes, we are free from the penalty of sin. We are now free from the power of sin. We have been reconciled to God and we have been empowered to live for God. But most importantly, the veil has been torn. We can come into God's presence anywhere, anytime, and speak, have a relationship, fellowship with God. It's the most precious thing Jesus gave us. Not just to be forgiven, but to have access to God. Not just one day when He returns, but today, now, here, everywhere. It's the most amazing thing. The question is, do you believe this? Do you believe? Because that's where it starts. That's where this adventure starts of getting to know God more. Not on a Sunday when you hear a preacher preach, but every day when you come to Him. I learn more about God in my personal time with Him than I ever did at Bible school. You don't need to study theology to know God. You can just take an hour a day, half an hour. and spend it with Him in His Word, and by His Spirit He will teach you all things. God wants to have a relationship with us. The question is, do we really want the relationship with Him? He has done everything. He's made a way for us. And we can. But what I've discovered is, to have this relationship with God, you need to diligently seek Him. You need to really desire it. You really need to pursue it. As if it is as valuable as the price that it took to enable us to get there. This was not easy. This was not cheap. It came at a price so that we don't have to pay that price. But do we really want it? So God says, if you diligently seek me, without faith it's impossible to please God. But those who come to Him must believe that He exists and that He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And it is so in my seeking Him that I find Him. God is closer to you than you think. The question is just, do you really want this intimacy with Him? I've discovered He's closer than what I thought He was. But I've also discovered that I can only truly find Him on His terms, not on mine. Because it's not about me. It is about Him. He is God. I am not. We honor Him most when we pursue this relationship He has paid for us. We honor Him most when we pursue this and His purpose first in our lives. The way we respond to this greatest day in history is not by the songs that we sing, but the lives that we live in response to what He has done. Not just to forgive us, but to give us access to Him. And when we pursue that most, it's like John Piper says, God is most glorified when we are most satisfied in Him. It is when we pursue this privilege that has been opened up to us by grace. When we pursue this with all our heart and passion, God is most glorified. Because that's why I sent my Son. And He says, you know what? It's worth it. Because I want to have intimacy, fellowship with you. Christ's death and resurrection was for us so that we may be reconciled to God in a relationship and His purpose. And it is in this fellowship, intimacy, and partnership that I have found most joy, peace, and blessing. The more I am in fellowship, participation, partnership, and intimacy with God, the more I have experienced the love, the joy, the peace, the blessing. All the promises in the Bible is yes and amen in Christ Jesus. The more I am in Him, the more these things become a reality. And I have found that this is far more precious than anything the world can offer us. So let us consider this Easter, not just what Jesus did for us, but the purpose of it all. Let us consider that. Why did He die? And why was He raised? And what did it produce? What did it open up? What grace are we standing in today? How are we responding to this? Let us respond in fellowship. Let us make a decision this Easter that from this Easter on, I will continue every day to celebrate in fellowship with Him. In that intimacy, in that partnership, in that participation. And you will reap what Christ said you will. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. And so I want to encourage you, as we conclude, let us live in fellowship with God for his glory and reap the life that he promises. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. That life that you had, it is nothing in comparison to the life I will give you. That life is in me. Do you believe this? I am the resurrection and the life. The life that I have for you is far more what you can ask for or imagine. If only you would come to me, seek me diligently, until you meet with me and live with me. So, Father, this morning, I pray that as we come to you, we come to you in gratitude, Lord, in worship, in thanksgiving to the price you paid to set us free, to redeem us, to wash us clean, to be justified. But Lord, this morning also we want to come to you and thank you for what it means, what it enables us not just to become, but the relationship that we can have with you. To have fellowship with you, restored. The veil is torn, God. We are back to where we were in the beginning in the garden. We can walk with you. And so, Lord, I pray that we will see this as precious as it really is. And while all the eyes are closed, if you are here this morning and you have never responded to God, you've never responded to this invitation, not to be forgiven, but to have a relationship. If that is you this morning, I want to give you an opportunity to respond to God while all the eyes are closed. It's just between you and God. God says, I want to know you. Not that I don't know you, but you don't know me. And I want you to know me. It's through my Son. If you want to know God, have a relationship with Him, surrender to Him, and grow in this intimacy with Him, and you've never done it before, I'm going to give you an opportunity right now to do that while all the eyes are closed, just to raise your hand and say, God, thank you. Is there anybody else? God, I want to give you my life. God, I want to respond to this sacrifice this morning. Is there anyone else? This is not for forgiveness. This is for a relationship. Is there anyone else? Thank you for that hand. Father, I want to thank you. You can drop your hands. I want to thank you, Father, for those who are responding to you, Lord. I thank you, God, that today you are embracing them, not just as forgiven, but you're embracing them on their desire to know you. And God, I pray, Lord, as they step into this intimacy with you, Lord, that you will open their eyes that they may see and know you more. Teach them your ways, Lord, that they may know you. Show them your love for them. May they hear your voice as they quiet themselves, as they search for you in the scriptures and in the silence, that they may hear you as you speak to them. And then for some others here today, God is inviting you to a new level of relationship with Him. Not just in the understanding of what He has done, but in the reality of that. If you have a desire to know Him more, if you have a desire to know Him as a Father that loves you, a Father that speaks to you, if you want to know Him as Jesus did, as the one that I see and hear, and you have a desire to grow in this relationship, I want you just to respond to Him by just raising your hand. Say, God, I want to know you more. I want to respond to the purpose of the sacrifice. You could just raise your hand and drop it. Nobody's looking. It's just between you and the Lord. just acting upon it. God sees your heart as you respond. Lord, I thank you for each and every heart that is responding for more of you. God, Holy Spirit, I pray that you will open their hearts, open their minds, open their spirits to receive more of you, Lord. Every time, Lord, they come closer to you, Lord, reveal yourself more. Teach them, Lord. Teach them yourself. Open the scriptures. Let them hear your voice. And God, I pray that you give them the grace to follow you, what they see and hear, that they might discover more. Every step we take closer to God, every step of obedience, every step of faith closer to Him, God reveals more of Himself. It's just the way it works. And so, God, I pray for each and every one of us that we will continue to step closer and closer to you. That we might discover how precious this fellowship with you truly is. That it will become the most precious thing. And everything else fades. In Jesus' name. Let's just stand together and let's worship the Lord. Father, thank you for giving us life. Thank you for saving us. Thank you that we can come as children into your presence and know we are accepted. That you hear us, that you love us, and you desire to reveal yourself more to us. I ask that this become real more and more in each, every one of us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for coming. May God bless you. Trust to see you again if you're here on holiday. Trust that you enjoy your stay. And we'll see you soon again. If you're in need of prayer, we're going to be here for a while. May God bless you.
your will.